and I'll record it here. Okay, so we are rolling. So this is the SOM Rising Leaders on Shaping Careers and Working Globally. Thanks to everyone who is here and to our lovely panelists who are able to join us for this, which should be a very interesting conversation tonight. We have a couple of things that I just want to make sure we're clear on in terms of orders of operations for the event. I'm going to start with some intros of our panelists, and then we can get into the discussion, and we'll have some time at the end to allow for questions and answers. So anyone who is in the audience, you should see a message from me. If you don't see it, that's okay. Use the Q&A button at the bottom of the screen to ask questions so that we can place them in front. Hopefully we can get to them at the end, depending on how much time we have left. So we'll be doing that, and we'll just get started. So this event is in collaboration with Chicago Women in Architecture, this is SOM Women's Initiative, coordinating a virtual panel. Coordinating a virtual panel to elevate women leaders in the firm's global practice. Moderated by me, Rachel Oleinick. I'm the CWA Lecture Chair and a Vice Principal at Northworks Architects here in Chicago. The panel is going to feature Tanvi Parikh, Laura Cavichioli, Marina Marquez, and Nicole Wang, four SOM colleagues who work across studios, disciplines, and areas of expertise. The panelists are going to discuss their career highlights, challenges, and pivots, as well as their personal and professional advice for peers in the industry. So I don't want to go through every single bio, but I will go to each of you and say, Tanvi, tell us about yourself. What would you want everyone here on our forum to know about you and your career?
Well, I would say I'm an architect, started out as an architect, and then moved on to larger scale planning and eventually pivoted into management. So now I'm a project manager at SOM.
Excellent, thank you. And Laura, how about you?
I have about 14 years of experience, seven of them in New York, seven of them here in Chicago with SOM. My focus is in residential. I am originally from Brazil, went to college in Savannah, Georgia, am a mother to a seven-year-old and a hedgehog.
I'm guessing the hedgehog is adopted.
Absolutely.
Excellent, thank you. Marina, why don't you tell us about yourself?
So I'm originally from Spain. I did my undergrad over there. I came to the US to New York to do my master's in urban design. And I joined SOM 6 years ago. And now I'm a design associate there.
Excellent. And last but definitely not least, Nicole, tell us about yourself.
Everyone, I am originally from the East Coast, but I'm now a West Coast transplant located in our San Francisco office. I started my career as an undergraduate in architecture and actually have a degree before making the switch to structural engineering towards the end of my undergrad career. I decided to come and get a master's in structural engineering in Northern California and have stayed ever since. And I'm currently at about 7 years here at SOM with our structures team in San Francisco.
Excellent. Thank you. So I want to talk a little bit. You're all at SOM and you're in different offices and sort of come to SOM from different, related, but some different backgrounds. What can you tell us about how SOM, your experience of SOM has been prior to the pandemic, because it is such a global company? What sorts of things are in place and that you've experienced or that you find advantageous? So Tanvi, can we start with you?
Sure. Yeah, so, you know, SOM, I mean, we are multidisciplinary, located across the continent in multiple offices. So even before the pandemic, we were used to working across offices, across disciplines, working different time zones and different continents. So in some ways, you know, we really benefited, I mean, just from having that experience even through the pandemic. It was such a, I would say, a seamless transition for us. And the talent that this brings and the things you learn with different disciplines, because you work, you know, it's all holistic thinking right from the beginning when you go into a project, whether it's a master planning project or it's an architecture project, you have all the disciplines at the table. So that's something that's really valuable and something that's really shaped, you know, how I think about work and projects that I engage on.
Laura, please.
Next. So pre-pandemic, of course, we were all at the office, right? There was the need to being at the office. Each person had their own desk and sat within their own studio. We had to schedule conference rooms, not only for informal meetings, but for client meetings, which meant that conference spaces were always in high demand and sometimes unavailable. We did see a shift in recent years. My son is coming too. Yes, no, take it. Sorry.
That's part of the experience in recent years towards
like more communal spaces and the idea of free address and our renovated office, which sort of happened right before the pandemic, has been a huge improvement from our little cubicles from back in the day, at least when I started. But the pandemic took everything online. And now meetings can be scheduled on Zoom anytime for any length. We're no longer restricted by room availability. Like Slack and other messaging systems give you direct access to people. So Q&A happens much, much faster. We have all sorts of software for collaboration. Like Tanvi was saying, we were kind of already there, but the pandemic just put it on steroids. You know, presentations are in the cloud and everyone can edit simultaneously, which means the production of content becomes a team effort instead of having a single person owning the entire presentation. And all of these adaptations that we had to incorporate in order to, let's say, effectively work from home have been a huge improvement to the overall workflow and efficiency. And then I would just add that on top of that, there's time saved on commute, there's money saved on transportation, healthier eating habits.
Well, some of
and more time spent with family and pets.
Mm-hmm. Definitely, definitely. Marina, can you tell us a little bit about how that shift has affected you in terms of, like, have you been working on teams that are at a global level where you have that kind of time zone difference? Yes, or anyone else who wants to jump in with that?
Yes, of course. So pre-pandemic, we were, of course, collaborating across offices, but I believe like not in the same way we're doing it now. It was more like, you know, looking for expertise. The sustainability team in Chicago, I've been working with them for like years already. But since we started working from home, I think, and Tanvi, you're a project manager, you know more of this than me, but there's been like also like an improvement in terms of staffing as well. So when you're like working on a project and you're missing this one member, like someone from London can just, you know, jump in and be part of the team, which was something that we weren't doing in that way before. So I feel like it has improved and I guess made better the life of project managers, because now, you know, the people you have to choose from to like be part of a project has become like wider, right?
Yeah, your resources are, you know, you're looking across resources. I mean, we were doing some of that, but I think it's much more flexible now. You know, it doesn't matter where you're sitting at this point.
Mm-hmm. Right. And there's also like the increasing flexibility as well when you're working on international projects. Like right now I'm working on projects in Middle East. So you have like meetings really early morning or like if you're working nation projects, you have meetings like really late evening. And so the flexibility of being able to be at home and jump in a meeting and then, you know, just continue with your life for a little bit and then like actually start working and be like 9 a.m., it has like become like, it's been a life changer.
Oh, and Marina, just for our audience, since they don't know where you're located currently, working from Spain.
Oh, you're asking? Yes, I'm in Spain right now. I moved temporarily here to seek family support. You know, like I have a 3-year-old daughter. When the whole situation started, it got a little complicated, like I guess for everyone that has kids. So, you know, we have our family here. So it was like much easier for us to like work from here. And even though like schedules are a little awkward or like out of the normal, it's been working great for us.
Yeah, and I just wanted to piggyback off of the comment that definitely it depends on the type of project schedule that you're on, but I've been currently working on a lot of Asian projects and being able to shift around that time has been really helpful. It's like, well, I had to, you know, stay on for all of China Day yesterday. Okay, I'm not gonna get up super early tomorrow morning or try to shift around the meetings to be towards the end of our San Francisco day. So it's been helpful to kind of have that flexibility. Another, I think, big thing that we had all kind of touched on before, but is, you know, the lack of physical barrier in the conversations that we've had, I think have been helpful in facilitating some of the conversations, especially across levels, right? When you're in the office, there's, you know, physically in our San Francisco office, all of our partners sit in these beautiful glass boxes in the middle of the office, right? But there's just that physical barrier of having the glass door there is sometimes, you know, maybe enough to deter you from wandering in randomly. But now with the tools that are available and the virtual climate that we're in now, right? There's oftentimes these, you know, opportunities to just ping people and say, hey, what do you think, right? That you might not have done with the physical office setting, but that have, you know, these kind of more spontaneous interactions have really been a byproduct of this working remotely and working internationally we may not have seen as much before.
And Nicole, do you feel that that is something that SOM is likely to adopt going forward, assuming that we're going to see the end of this pandemic at some point? How do you see these kinds of changes being adopted or maybe not adopted?
I was just going to say, you know, and it's like, we're all going to see how this evolves as we move into like, how's this going to change how we work moving forward, and this whole global workplace impact that this is going to bring on. We're already seeing, you know, now with the vaccinations available, you're reading every day, some companies are almost at 90%, 100%, you know, people have returned. And there are companies that are still fully remote. And then there are companies, especially the tech companies that always adapt so quickly, who have said, we're never going back. And, you know, the impact it's going to have on real estate. So there's going to be so many versions that it'll be interesting to see, you know, how many of these companies go back full time, or their hybrid options, or people really go fully remote or work from home. And, you know, as designers, I mean, we all know at SOM, I mean, we love working together. We love to collaborate. We love to have our drawings in front of us where everybody can get a marker in their hand and sketch on it. So we've adapted beautifully and using a lot of different technologies, you know, the whiteboards and all of that. But it'll be interesting to see, you know, how much of this sustains and, you know, people will keep this going and, you know, will move to a more hybrid or we'll go back to old ways. We'll see. I mean, I feel some changes are here to stay.
Yeah. I don't think the office setting is ever going to become irrelevant. Like Tanvi was saying, it's very important for certain things, especially when it comes to reviewing materials and, you know, that sort of collaboration that can be done online. But I don't think that back to the office will mean Monday through Friday, 9 to 5. I expect some type of permanent hybrid where at a very minimum, there's the option to work remotely for at least part of the week. Mm-hmm. I also think there's going to be a greater focus on wellness, not only in terms of amenities offered to employees, but also in terms of implementation of touchless technology wherever possible, just to minimize transmission of germs. And I'm not speaking for SOM, I'm speaking just in general. And speaking of germs, I don't know why it used to be such taboo to call in sick, but I don't expect that coming to work sick will be a thing anymore, especially since we proved that we can work just fine from home.
Yeah, I would say as long as we can communicate, connect, and continue to be creative and innovative, you know, the new models will work.
So tell me a little bit about what that connectivity looks like, because I've heard from a lot of other folks and have been on a panel myself that discussed the change between that sort of casual interaction or, mm-hmm. or organic interaction where you're running into somebody or you're overhearing something that happens in an office setting, but is now something that has to be much more intentional. Can you talk a little bit about how SOM is doing that or what your experiences have been with that?
It does definitely require some more proactiveness from your side. Of course, you know, the spontaneity of like running into someone or like just turning around and talking to whoever is sitting next to you, it's gone. But I think, you know, we just have to make a little bit more effort and just like connect mm-hmm. on Slack and be like, hey, how you doing? How's your day going, right? And I feel like SOM has been really supportive on that. And ever since the beginning of like moving and starting working from home, you know, they've been sending guidelines all along saying like, hey, just remember like every time at the beginning of the conversation, don't talk straight about work. Just ask your peers how they're doing. Make sure you turn off your turn on your camera so you see each other's faces. And I feel like at the beginning, it was a little, you know, complicated to do everything. Like no one really knew Zoom. You were connected on your phone with the camera, but then on your computer for the audio, and like no one really knew what they were doing. But I feel like, you know, after a year, it has become so much more natural that like spontaneous conversations just like come naturally mm-hmm. on Zoom. I mean, it's the new way, right?
And SOM, sorry, I keep talking.
I'm gonna get back to Nicole after you.
In SOM specifically, we use Slack as a messaging system. There are dozens of channels, right? And it's like, it's firm-wide. Anybody can be a part of it. There's all sorts of topics. There's a topic that's called random, you know, and it's really fun to see a firm-wide engagement because, you know, the good thing about being at the office is that you do get to overhear and like mingle with people that you wouldn't otherwise mingle with. But we're getting to do that, you know, firm-wide. I mean, it wasn't until last year that I started, you know, creating relationships with people from the LA office and people from the London office and, you know, people from everywhere. And there's a huge employee camaraderie. And of course, let's not forget the importance of happy hour.
Yeah, and just to bounce off of that idea, you know, before the structures group is about 30 people across the three main offices and a group of about 10 engineers in London. But before, we didn't really have a forum for everyone to be on the same call. But I think, you know, shortly after we moved to work from home, we started having these firm-wide meetings, and you can actually see, you know, all the structural engineers in the office learn about what people are good at, what people know. And I think it's been kind of an invaluable resource in kind of getting to know the group as a whole, and not just, you know, before, like our interaction inter-office might have been that little paper envelope where you send inter-office mail, right? Like you may not, unless you get the opportunity to actually physically travel to another office, you might not get to meet your peers. And now with Zoom and with these kind of sometimes daunting, you know, large calls where you have like 100 people in attendance and you have to talk, but you know, it's still a good avenue to see people's faces, kind of hear what other people are thinking, doing, and in sharing these experiences across, you know, the larger group, I think has been really valuable.
I want to return to something that you had said earlier, Nicole, about taking the barriers down between management and staff. It sounds like that is something that is essential, really, for anyone who wants to continue to advance their career. Can you talk a little bit more about that, like your personal experience, and I'll have others fill in as well. Just being able to sort of say, hey, I wasn't always able to have this conversation because you had a big glass office.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. With the spontaneity of Zoom calls and so on and so forth, and Slack as well. I think Slack has been a huge way, you know, people might not answer you immediately, but even just like being able to click, okay, partner A, right? I'm gonna say hi, right? And just kind of taking that opportunity to reach out to someone has been a huge benefit from work from home, honestly, I think. I think I used this word last time, being a little bit shameless about reaching out to people and whenever you need them, because in this day and age, right, people are busy, right? They're juggling their lives, they're juggling work, they're juggling health, right? Everything that we do have to worry about. It's hard, you know, as a manager, right, to make sure that every single need is accounted for. So from across all levels, I think it's really beneficial to kind of take things into your own initiative and reach out. And I'd love to hear what others have to think as well.
Yeah, I'd like to hear what Tanvi has to say.
Yeah, I mean, I would say, you know, absolutely. I mean, it's critical to speak up and reach out, and especially in this remote setting, you know, you don't have the opportunities for those informal conversations. And so not everybody's the type to reach out. So it is challenging sometimes, you know, some people are inherently shy. So the same people, you could have just nudged them, hey, what's going on? You know, you walk by their desk, but you don't have those impromptu opportunities. So what, and this is something, I mean, we are all going to learn as we go along. I mean, we were in this stable position. We went into the pandemic. We went into a remote mode. And only now we are starting to probably bring in new employees. And as the onboarding happens, you know, how do you introduce people to your work culture? I mean, there's always a company culture. And this is going to be something that we're all going to learn. You know, this mentorship, you know, that is like, are we going to do Zoom mentorship? So I think those are things where, you know, people will start to feel like, oh, I wish I were in the same room with this person and I could turn around and say, hey, I need help. So I think there are certain challenges to remote. I mean, not everything's ideal about it, but there's definitely, you know, many of us, and, you know, as Laura and as so many of us have pointed out, it's just like when you have kids and, you know, for women who are juggling work and home and, you know, or even men who are juggling multiple fronts, just having that predictability and a schedule that you can follow, that's, I think, the most important thing for some level of sanity in our lives. And in some ways, I feel the remote work from home has given me much more control. And, you know, I'm putting in way more hours than I ever did. But that's because I was commuting so long. I was exhausted from the commute. When I'm at work, you know, you're still managing your life back home with your kids. Are they back from school? You know, even if someone's watching them, there's all that added thing. And now I sit like a queen in my study, but I have full control of the house, the office, across offices. I feel so much more in control. So I, like Laura said, I really hope, you know, some of this can stay because it has given me much more ability to be productive and less distracted. While I know different people have different opinions, and a lot of people feel they're more distracted from home, while I feel I'm much more productive at home. So, yeah, it just depends on your where you are in your life and career.
Yeah, that's definitely something I've heard, that the folks who have years of experience have also the experience of discipline to say, okay, here's mm-hmm. the work that I'm going to be doing. I can manage this for myself. But the fact that you say that you've worked so much more time during the pandemic than you have during the office starts to concern me. Can you talk, and anyone else, can you talk a little bit more about, is there a shift in the expectation, or is this sort of a blurring of work and home? What do you see that as?
Someone else wants to go, otherwise I'll keep talking on this.
Marina, do you want to go?
Sure. I mean, we are all, I think, like putting more hours, but it's not hours that you would be not working before. I mean, it's hours that you'll be commuting, for example, like your 2 hours of, you know, take your kid to daycare, like then from daycare to work, prepare in the morning, like all of those things are gone. So like all that extra time that you had, like sometimes gets invested in work. Like in my case, I wouldn't say like I work more hours, I just work them differently. So instead of like having a full day that is like 9 to 5, I do like, you know, a pocket here, or maybe like I'm like, also because I'm in a different time zone, so that makes things like a little bit like, it's like another twist to it. But like I put like 4 hours in the morning and then 3 hours in the afternoon and then another 4 hours in the evening. So you end up doing your full day or maybe like a little extra. But as Tanvi was saying, like you're controlling other aspects of your life in the meantime. So I guess, yeah, again, it depends on what point in your life or your career are at. But at least for me, it's working.
Mm-hmm. I'll go next. First of all, I find work-life balance to be extremely important. I always have. And in many ways, I think the pandemic made it worse to find that balance. I know that for me at the beginning, it was complete insanity because I was working from home, learning all this new technology, but also helping my son study from home and work all that technology. And I was also cooking lunch, which I wouldn't otherwise be doing if I was at the office, if he was at school. So are we working more? Yes, but it's not that we're working more hours. I'd say we're working the same amount of hours for work or the same amount of hours that you would allow yourself to work. And then there's the layers that you add to it because you're also doing housework and you're cooking and you're helping your child with school. But these extra layers of work are great. I mean, I used to go to work before my kid woke up and come home. By the time I'm home, it's late. You know, during the winter, I didn't see sunlight because I'd get to the office when it was still dark and I'd leave the office and it was already dark and I'd get home tired and I wouldn't want to play. And there's just this, I feel like we've gotten to experience life or merge work and home life. And it's been wonderful. Even though it's been hard, it's also been wonderful.
Yeah, like before, how many times your kid would visit you in the office, right? Like for the Christmas party. Like now it's every single day.
You could bring people to your Christmas party? We
only
we
kids.
Couldn't.
It was a party for kids.
Drinking age only.
Yeah, and I just wanted to add, I mean, it's definitely that wintertime adjustment with daylight savings has been really nice this past winter, you know, experiencing for the first time not having to come home like when it's already all dark out, or being able to I honestly have my everyday mental clarity walk you know, sometime in the afternoon after lunch, and being able to go on that every day, whether it's a run or a walk, is really nice. And being able to shift around the hours. I don't have the same commitments. I don't have kids or anything, but being able to shift around time in the schedule to hours that I know I'm going to be more productive rather than just working like a slog of hours in the middle of the day, which might not be ideal for a variety of reasons. And being, you know, sometimes the office is really busy. And so having kind of the quietness of being at home, even if you're partners on the phone the whole day too, but you know, being in this kind of focused environment for me at least has been really productive. However, I think one thing to add though is that with trying to manage a team and not being co-located, especially you know, as an engineer, we're very technical. We rely on each other as a technical resource. There are often times where, you know, I turn to the person who used to sit next to me in the office and say, like, you know, oh, do you have this code or whatever. It's hard, right, not being located to ask these kind of sometimes silly questions, or these questions that, you know, are really based on engineering judgment, And the same for people who I manage as well. I'm sure it's hard not being able to run across the office and find your supervisor, your manager. But I think we're all adapting. And so it's, again, it's really just about reaching out when you need the help, right? Being able to find the resources that you think you need.
Yeah. I mean, it's all about, drawing those boundaries and finding and carving out time for yourself. And I got ways to go for that, but I'll get there.
And I just want to say one thing about work-life balance. This is really targeted at the younger crowd on this call. Work-life balance is self-imposed. You need to know when to stop. The work is never finished. And, it could go on forever. So it's up to us as individuals to find what works for us and to stop when you need to stop.
I mean, do you find that that is part of the SOM culture too? And how do you reinforce that in this new scenario where we are so individualized now?
Well, the firm has enforced it in a way where, we have town halls every other week. And, there was a whole presentation on the importance of finding this balance. I think they realized that some people were getting burnt out. And, they're for it, They want us to be healthy and aware and sharp. It's hard to be sharp at work when you're completely burnt out. So taking that time to yourself is very important. It doesn't matter if you have family or not. Take some time to yourself.
So I'd like to hear a little bit about how you all sort of designed your career and how that's led you to this point and where you see that trajectory going, knowing that the pandemic has really made a change in everybody's life, and how you've sort of adapted to that change, where you think you're going to be going. Tanvi, can we start with you?
Sure. I mean, like I said, I came from the undergrad in architecture, and, my interest was always large-scale planning. So I went on to get a master's in urban design and planning. And then when I got out, when I was graduating, it's a funny story. SOM was on campus for interviews, and I wasn't signing up. And some of my close friends were like, you have a perfect background, because it was a planning school, right? It was a policy school. So there were very few people with the design background. So some of my friends were, that's a perfect match for you. And I was like, no, it's too corporate. I'm not going there. It's big. It's not my type. And, you never know where life leads you. So I did go on. I joined the city design practice group back then, just an urban planning group. And I worked as a designer for many years before I returned to India for a few years. My husband and I decided to move back. So we spent a few years there and came back. And then after some more moves and global, finding the perfect home, we landed back in Chicago, and I came back to Chicago. So when I came back, at that point, it had been a few years now. And, not a lot of us would say it. And a few years ago, if you asked me professionally, I wouldn't say it loudly, but I had taken a substantially long break after my kids were born. And some of it, because I wanted to, and some of it because I hadn't predicted the 2008 economic crisis that would hit right in the middle of it. So when I came back, I was like, I just need to get my foot back in now. And this is where I sometimes tell a lot of younger people, like, you really need to prove yourself in the initial years, because you never know what life goes. And to have those mentors and those champions who believe in you and who've seen you, who are not going to look at that hole in your resume and say, oh, my God, why would I hire you? So, I mean, that's what worked in my favor. And I really owe it to the people who knew me from before and brought me back at SOM. And I, at that point, when I was coming back, I was going to go back to business school, and I was told, like, why would you go back to business school? We'll teach you management here at SOM. So so I did come back, thinking, Well, that's not a bad option, and I'll go into management. I also thought that it would be easier than being back on the drawing boards and thinking of all those long all-nighters that I had pulled as a very young designer at SOM. Little did I know that that's not the reality, whether you're in design or management. You know, work is work, and you never know. But that's definitely something, you know, that changed my career decision at that point. And I don't think any of us go to undergraduate thinking, I'm going to come out and be a project manager. So, you know, it's like you read Fountainhead when you're in school, and that's what you're going to do. So it is, you know, it's just, it's something that life and career always, you follow your heart, but you also follow what the reality of your life is. And you say, it's worked wonderfully for me. I mean, I really enjoy the role I'm in, and I always like to have this place where I had a bigger understanding of everything that was going on around. I could never work in my silos, so it's a perfect position for me.
Marina, can you tell us about your career path and how the pandemic has maybe changed your trajectory or not?
Yeah, so I did my undergrad in Spain, and also the 2008, as like too many to us, sort of like changed my life. And at that point, there were like no jobs in Spain, like at all. So we decided, okay, let's try to go to New York and go to grad school over there. And that's how the whole thing started, like 10 years ago. And I actually, my interest was focused on urban design as well. But I found at the beginning, like, you know, a little bit harder to find a job in urban design. So I started like doing architecture, which is what I had like, you know, an 8-year undergrad for. And so I kept on going in architecture. And when I joined SOM, I had like a really funny story that I like applied for both positions. I was interested in the company, and they had an opening in urban design, another one in architecture. And I was like, okay, I can do both. So I applied, got a job in architecture. And the day I'm sitting in my desk, I get an email like, oh, are you available for an interview at SOM Urban Design? And I'm like, I'm sitting in the floor right below to yours. nice to meet you.
That's terrific.
And so that's how I ended there. I do not believe myself like a specialized person. I think my focus has been like on diversifying all along. Like, and I've worked in like different stages of the project, different markets. I've done from like master planning to like I'm working on a bridge right now. And I think that works great for me. I think that's, you know, architecture is such a broad field that I took the opportunity, and I've been like, you know, painting here and there and like trying to do a little bit of everything.
Laura, why don't you tell us about your trajectory and how 2008 creamed you too, like it has done so many of us.
Well, I can't say that I've designed my career. I've typically gone with the flow, and I've followed my interests, and I've followed my instincts wherever they led me. And they led me straight to residential. I just, you know, I tried a little bit of everything, and I just always gravitated back to residential. It's what I love, and it's what I will continue to do. I don't think the pandemic changed that respect of my career trajectory. And I guess to the young listeners today, I'd say, you know, be open to new opportunities. Don't be afraid to try new things, because that's how you're going to find out what you truly love. You know, and if you ever want to specialize, that's the only way you'll know.
Now, I really want to hear from Nicole, since she change trajectories pretty early.
Yeah. So I was also at one point in time thought I would be an architect since I was like 4 probably. I remember going to Hong Kong for the first time being super excited about tall buildings. So, you know, when I started my undergrad, I actually did 4 years of architecture. But I also discovered that, you know, I was pretty good at math and science, and decided to pursue a double major pretty early on in both civil engineering and architecture. And it came to the hard point of, you know, I'd done a couple of architecture internships and, you know, worked as a researcher with a couple of my studio professors and was kind of like, you know, is this something that I can see myself doing long term? And, you know, thankfully at that point, I had a good champion who offered me my first structural engineering internship. Kind of a big risk because I, at that point I had a lot of architecture under my belt, very little engineering under my belt. But you know, I got to see that being an engineer doesn't necessarily mean that you're just running calculations and models and, you know, talking to contractors all day, right? There is also a design aspect to it. And at that point it was, you know, pretty cool to see that a lot of the skills that I had in my architecture training really applied also to engineering as well. So when I went out for my first full-time opportunity, I think that really helped actually balance out my portfolio and my resume at that time. And even today, right, at some point you do have to make a decision. Are you an architect? Are you an engineer? But you're really able to use your skills either way, right? And to some degree, that kind of shapes the work that I've been doing at SOM. We work on a lot of unique projects, not just tall buildings, but also, you know, sculptures and like the one behind me. There's a wide portfolio of work that we do, and it's been really exciting to be able to work on all of these, not only as an integrated design team with the architects and MVP engineers and sustainability specialists and all the who work at SOM, but also being able to work with artists and other people on very interesting collaborations. So it's been a good place to kind of, you know, nurture all these interests that I have.
You mentioned champions, and I know Tanvi had mentioned champions and mentors earlier in the discussion. Can you talk a little bit about what the difference is between a mentor and a champion and how you went about finding or seeking out or stumbling upon these people who may have had a significant impact in your careers?
I mean, I can say, I don't necessarily think I went out seeking either. And, you know, it's just sort of organically happened in the early years. You know, there were some people I worked with, some women I work with, you know, and strong women. And I remember those early conversations around work-life balance and when I had no clue, because at that point it was only work, there was no life. And they said some things that kind of stayed with me and over my career, you know, when I go back and I think about it and it made so much sense. It's like, oh yeah, I can imagine how hard it must have been when you were working with me at 10 p.m. and you had a child who was 4 and you hadn't seen that child in the morning and you weren't going to see that child in the evening. So I think there are so many things that you don't really realize it till you obviously go through it. So yeah, I would say there were mentors such as that who taught me that, yes, you will eventually in your life, if that's what you choose, you with or without kids, I mean, you want to find a work-life balance for sure. And we all talk about it, but we also have to find ways to really achieve it. And for champions, and I would say that's again happened organically where, you know, if you work with people, really good people, talented people, and you can prove what you can bring to the table, doesn't matter how many years pass and, you know, they will still have good words for you. And that's really critical in any industry where you are to have those people who can, you know, put in a good word for you.
Do you find that with the remote work that you sort of have to toot your own horn a little bit to cultivate that kind of relationship? Sort of what Nicole was saying earlier about being a little shameless. What do you think has changed since you're not necessarily in an office with someone for an all-nighter anymore?
Absolutely. I think that's something you have to do more and more. Even your work, like, you know, Laura said, I think Marina said, it's like, you don't know how many, no one knows what exactly you're working, right? So even, are you overloaded? Are you underutilized? You know, you need to be your own advocate and you need to speak up. And I think it also comes from the leadership, and you know, we have some great leaders in our firm, and you know, they're organizing these town halls to really engage everyone to talk about these issues and acknowledge these issues. I think those are really important steps, and I think SOM is doing a lot with the TED committee and you know, issues on equity, on diversity, and I mean, it's all part of it, and just being able to talk and go after what you need. I mean, if you need to reach out to the partners, you need to reach out to your managers, your teammates, and let everyone know what you're doing. I think it's really critical. But you're right, you really have to speak up, and it's not going to happen organically anymore.
But I don't think it would happen organically before either. Like, I feel like there's always been that like sort of like fear from like young staff, including myself, to like mm-hmm. be able to voice like what you need or what you want at that specific time. And even like for your workload, like to set up expectations is really important. You need to like say what you can and what you believe you can't do, or what you know and what you don't know how to do. Because otherwise no one will be able to help you. So I think it's very important. It was very important before as well, to like just, you know, like right now it's different. You just like send a Slack and be like, hey, can we have a conversation? It doesn't have to be now. It's not urgent, but like any moment that you have some time, please give me a call. Before, you will like go into your supervisor desk and be like, hey, can we talk a little bit later? So I think it's like part of like the same process. It's just on a computer instead of like in person.
A little of the pressure is off, maybe.
Probably, yes. Actually, yes. Because the whole like shameless thing, at least for me, it's like easier on the computer. You just like write the text and click enter. That's it. And then, you know, that'd be it.
Laura, what were you going to say?
I was just going to say that finding a mentor, at least in my perspective, happens organically. Not everyone is a good mentor, even if they're great at what they do, right? There's a difference between being told what to do, being told how to do it, and being taught, right? Why and how and you know, the conversations, sharing of knowledge, sharing the good, but also the bad. Like, so this conversation typically in my case grows into friendship. And I used to have my coffee meetings with my mentor, who's also my friend, and he's got so many years of experience. And when the pandemic hit, what did I do? I set up Zoom coffee meetings, and we have coffee every morning, and we don't work on the same projects most of the time, but we talk about what we're working on, what's happening in their jobs, you know, what kind of, if they're having any issues, and we help each other work things out. And it's fantastic. I do recommend that, you know, once you find that person who's a good fit for you, definitely try to cultivate a friendship, and don't approach that person only with questions, you know, engage. There's so much knowledge around, you know.
Yeah, I would agree that I think finding a mentor is much more of an organic process, and it's different for every person. And you know, it's really about developing a relationship with a person. You have continual dialogue, right? Both of you grow from that relationship. Whereas I think championing is maybe more impromptu, more spontaneous, right? Colleagues can champion each other. It doesn't need to be someone kind of extending their hand down to help you up, to help you climb up, right? It's, and I think right now that, you know, in this role where we all are kind of isolated, right, there is an opportunity to kind of help each other and champion the good work that everyone is doing, because we know everyone's working hard. And sometimes it just takes, you know, a couple of people's acknowledgement to really help them along. So for me, championing is like a super, super important, especially in this age where we all are separate. And it's good to, you know, help others achieve that exposure and, you know, help the greater group see their good work.
Excellent. Excellent. So we do have a couple of questions from the attendees who, actually, I think we covered one of them shortly after it was posted. So I'm going to read a couple of these off. But before I do, are there any last bits of advice that you would have given to your younger self or someone who you think might be in the audience or who could use some like, oh, gosh, I wish I had known this 20 years ago.
Can I go first?
Please do.
Get your license before you decide to start a family. It's not impossible. I did it, but it's exponentially harder. And what makes it more difficult is you need time to study. And when you have a baby, it's really, really hard to find the time. So like I said, doable, but easier if you do it before. Get licensed.
I would say, you know, just to all the women out there, it's like women are just natural leaders, I think. We're good listeners. We are very empathetic. And we really do well in management. So, you know, keep pushing. And this pandemic has set a lot of women behind in the terms that I know so many people talk about challenges and childcare and how people have taken a back seat or, you know, reduced their hours, and not just in our industry, but everywhere. But I think we've come a long way and we just keep pushing forward. But at the same time, live life to the fullest and try not to have insane expectations, because we don't need to prove it to anyone.
I think the one thing I would have told myself, you know, back in college or at the beginning of my career, is that it's not static, right? I think on the panel today, we have excellent examples of people who have, you know, tried a couple things, right? It's meant to be a developing thing. And also for me as well, right? I learn every day about what I like, what I don't like, and what I think I will do with my career in the future. So it's not a straight line. It's not something that you need to subscribe to and you can't, right? Can't change it in the future. So I think that's what I would tell myself.
I think I would say, like, we've heard it a couple of times today, like, speak up, tell, you know, what your needs are, what you want to achieve. But also I would tell myself, be patient, like, speak up, but be patient. Like, maybe the opportunity is not now, and maybe they can't give you what you need right now. But, and especially at a place like SOM, where there's like so many things happening, so many projects, so many opportunities, that thing you want is gonna be possible at some point, but you might not be able to have it like now. So learn how to wait, learn that everything flows and that at some point it'll be your opportunity. And maybe at that point it's not that one, the one you want, maybe something different, but please be patient and don't stress out about it.
Don't stress out. Excellent advice. Okay, so I have a few questions here. If anyone has a very strong excitement about a particular question, by all means, I don't think we're going to have time for everybody. We're not going to have time to answer every question, and we're not going to have time for everybody to give a response, I don't think. So I'm going to read some off, and if you're excited about it, jump right in. So this is from Emily Klingensmith. Great to hear all of your comments. Thank you. Can you speak to how you've handled mentoring new or newer team members and how you try to maintain and build office culture during the pandemic? And we did touch on this a little bit earlier. Anyone excited about this? Or want to recap what we had said earlier? I think, Tanvi, you had mentioned something to this effect.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I said it always happened organically, I felt. And, you know, at SOM, we're also trying to do this one-on-one mentorship for year one students. And, you know, we've done a lot. And Even now during the pandemic, we've continued with these remote mentorship programs. So there's a little more organized program, but not every place has that. So I would say you seek out, but for the person who's, you know, in a position where you're mentoring younger people, I would say you also need to take the same amount of initiative, organize some regular check-ins with the team, with them. And, you know, we have so many ways. I mean, I have people who are on Slack who will ask me questions all the time, you know, and so you have multiple channels to reach out. So just go ahead and, you know, like Nicole always says, be shameless about it. And you need to reach out and
mm-hmm. manage up, not just manage down.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Excellent. Thank you. We have this from an anonymous person. Isn't it more exhausting having home life and work life merge? But tell us, Laura, do you want to take this one?
It's exhausting, but it's also fantastic. Can it be the same? Can the two exist, coexist?
It's exhausting and fantastic.
Yeah, I mean, we are now, you know, we're working just as hard, if not harder. We are cooks, you know, we are teachers, we are the cleaning lady. It all has to happen, you know, within our day. And it's tough, but I don't know, maybe the 2 hours saved in commute makes us feel lighter. I don't know how to explain it. I will say it was very tough at first, but you know, once you get used to the routine, you learn to enjoy it. At least that's been my personal experience.
I agree. I mean, I think, like Laura said, it's the commute, the exhaustion that came with it. And hey, if you're going into office, you need it to look pretty too. I mean, you know, I only have to worry about the face, you know. There's so much time in a day that is saved. And, you know, I think there, all of that, it translates to whether you put in some extra time at work or extra time with your household chores or just relaxing. But I think there's a good balance. But I'm sure we are all at a point where we also want to get out and see people and meet people. And, you know, it's just I think there's got to be a balance. And I feel there's no going back to the 9 to 5 from Monday to Friday. I mean, there's a lot of people who are going to ask for other flexible options. And, you know, we'll see how firms will evolve.
Excellent. So I think we have time for maybe just one more question. Let's see. We've got so many good ones here. Okay, so this is from Julie Obrokta. I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing it. We'd love to hear about the panelists' single best choice they made in their career. So that can go to anybody. You made no good choices in your career, and you're just like, oh my gosh, I'm having a crisis.
Julie says sorry.
Okay, I guess. You want to turn it around and say the worst choice that you made and how from it?
I was going to say, you know, life is about multiple choices. I feel there wasn't any one turning point, and you know, you make so many little choices. It's like, oh, am I interested in working in the China market? I mean, this was a thing, you know, happened for many years. We talked about it. I'm just talking personally. And a couple of years ago, I sort of, you know, the situation was such there was no one to manage it. And I jumped in and, you know, I'm really thrilled that I learned a whole new market that I grew up in India, so not too far from China. But somehow when you grow up in India, you look to the west more than the north or the south or the east of you. So I would have known more about the 50 states of United States, less about the biggest rivers in China. But, you know, it's just, I mean, you learn a whole different culture and a whole different market. And so these are things, I mean, you're sometimes scared to take the plunge, and you go in knowingly or unknowingly, and it can work out for the better. So yeah, it's, you know, those kind of chances in my life that I've taken, and I feel they've always been positive.
Mm-hmm. That's a question I think everybody should answer. What was the best decision you made in your career?
I think the best decision I made was to make the choice and tell my supervisors that I wanted to specialize. You know, and I've done everything and I continue to do everything because I think, as some of the women here have touched on, we are now a firm-wide practice, and if you're ever slow on your project, they lend you to different offices and different projects, and it's been so much fun. But if you know what you love and you make your voice heard, because nobody's gonna know unless you tell them. And the fact that I told them, this is what I want to be doing, please let me pursue this and only this, I think that was important to me. Mm-hmm.
Great answer.
I don't know that I've made that single best choice.
Doesn't have to be like best choice and everything from here is like, you know, downhill. Best choice so far.
I think it is probably, you know, deciding to become an engineer, and also I guess making a choice and a good place to start my career, because, you know, I've had those opportunities that I was probably looking for but didn't know existed out there. So it's, for me, yeah, maybe it was starting at SOM. Mm-hmm.
All right, Marina.
Moving to New York, I mean, that was like, if not the single one, the biggest mm-hmm. change in my career. And yeah, I mean, and it was really challenging, you know, like leaving your country behind and your family and so forth. But it's something that many people in the office have done. And I think for all of us, it's been, you know, one of the most important choices in our careers.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
Well, Rachel, are you going to... are we ending? Or there was one question here I was looking from Rebecca, you know, through the chat. And
oh, sure.
I was looking at Rebecca's question on, you know, how do you feel about being assertive or dealing with stress and, mm-hmm. you know, taking on masculine characteristics in the workplace. And I really wanted to address that because, you know, it is a panel of women and, you know, we all understand sort of the underlying issues and, you know, biases, and we all talk about this. But I would say at SOM, I mean, there's been a lot of torchbearers, and so we're not the first. I mean, to be assertive and to be aggressive is not necessarily seen as a lot of times, you know, how women are portrayed. It's like, oh my gosh, she's so assertive, or she's just so unfriendly, or, you know.
Assertive is not the word that typically gets used.
Right. So, yeah, I think, you know, at SOM, I think we typically, I feel I've not come across that. I'm not, you know, as strong either on some of those things. I mean, I don't come across that strongly. I have a slightly more pleasant personality across, I don't know, my colleagues would have to say that. But I feel, you know, we could be what we want to be and how we want to be here. And I've never seen a pushback or, you know, negative connotations to if I were speaking up against something or someone, or, you know, it's always been positive conversations. So mm-hmm. I wouldn't say any of us should fear about those biases as much here. Mm-hmm. At least we work in a much more open environment.
Mm-hmm. Any other last thoughts? Actually, I meant to ask this at the very beginning. Tell me about the images that you have behind each of you. And we'll have to close with that, I'm afraid, because we're just about out of time.
I can start. I guess late last year, through our collaboration with the art, Jenna Eckelman, who is an artist based out of Boston, we unveiled this sculpture in very close to Seoul, South Korea. So it's been an ongoing, like 5 to 6 year collaboration at this point, with many both built and unbuilt projects. But yeah, this is the latest one to be opened.
Is that Janet Edelman?
Eckelman.
Yes.
Love her work.
Very, very cool. Thank you.
Project. Sorry. So mine is a project in Argentina. It's called Catalina's Rio. Office building filled with a lot of collaborative spaces and outdoor spaces. And it's the first deadline we had while working from home. So I thought it was made a lot of sense to put in the background. So I think we had the deadline, I don't know, like 2 months after we started working from home. So like it was really challenging because we didn't like, we weren't under control of our own lives still, but I feel really proud of the whole team and how we put it together.
Okay, I'll go next. Can't tell, but I am sitting in a living room and it's dark, so maybe I'll switch backgrounds. This is the Lincoln Common, a two residential towers mm-hmm. that I had the pleasure to work with on, sorry, in Lincoln Park. And it was just a wonderful experience. A wonderful 4-year experience.
Okay. So behind me, I have what's called the Wild Mile. You can see written on that rendering. This is a project on the North Branch Canal and the Turning Basin on the Chicago River that we worked on a few years ago. And, you know, fingers crossed, we continue to see some development of floating gardens and, you know, naturalizing the edges, and the city is continuing to work on that. And I'm really excited. It's been a while. I haven't been out there. And this spring, I want to see what new, you know, vegetation and wildlife is being restored. And hope to see that project in full glory in a few years. You know, it's like the Chicago River. It takes many years. I mean, that's the thing about planning projects, right? You got to think long and, you know, have a forward vision. So someday we'll all get to enjoy it.
I hope someday soon. Well, excellent. Thank you. Thank you so much. And thanks for everyone who joined us this evening. I hope you had an enlightening experience. We will have a recording up on the CWA site at some point, and we'll probably be sharing it also with SOM. So stay tuned for that. And that's it. Have a great evening, everybody. Thanks so much.
Thanks.